Good evening to everyone. Please, dear devotees in the Dhamma, faithful children and Dhamma friends, please recite Namo Tassa three times in order to observe the five precepts as our usual practice before starting the Dhamma talk. Namo Tassa. Repeat after me. Buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dhammaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Sanghaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dutiyampi buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Dutiyampi dhammaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Tatiyampi buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Tatiyampi dhammaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Tatiyampi sanghaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. Saraṇā gamanaṃ sampunnaṃ. Pānātipātā vīramanī sikkhāpadaṃ samādiyāmi. Adinnādāna vīramanī sikkhāpadaṃ samādiyāmi. Kāmeṣu micchācārā vīramanī sikkhāpadaṃ samādiyāmi. Musāvādā vīramanī sikkhāpadaṃ samādiyāmi. Surāmeraya majjapamādattānā vīramanī sikkhāpadaṃ samādiyāmi. Tisaraṇena saddhiṃ pañcaśīlaṃ dhammaṃ sādukaṃ surakkitaṃ kattvā appamādena sampādetabbaṃ. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Dānaṃ sīlaṃ ca nikkhammaṃ paññā viriyena pañcamaṃ. Kanti saccha madiṭṭhānaṃ mettupekkhāti mādassa. Dear children and faithful devotees in the Dhamma, wholesome friends, wholesome children, as usual, today you all are here. You all have gathered here in order to listen to the teachings of the Buddha. As you know that today is our monthly Dhamma talk day, as usual, you all know that we have been conducting this series of Dhamma talk last few months. So still we are facing some problems of coronavirus, so still we are conducting this Dhamma talk as a virtual talk. So I hope you will join me from being at home in order to listen to the teachings of the Buddha. As you know that I have selected a special topic which you all know about, that is perfections paramita, and we have talked two paramitas last month and the month before that. So today I am going to talk about the third perfection, third paramita, third one. So before that, I want to give you some explanation how you should listen to the teachings of the Buddha. As you know that if you are a usual member or listener of my Dhamma talk, you know that what are the steps that you need to go through in order to listen to the teachings of the Buddha. So before you start listening to the talk, you must complete three steps, right? If you complete those three steps, then actually you can benefit, or you can gain, or you can get the real benefits of the teachings of the Buddha. So what is the first step that you need to follow, you need to fulfill, or you need to undertake? The first one is sunata. You must listen carefully. You must pay your attention to the talk with full of concentration and with full of attention. Right? Why do I say that? Because if you do not pay your attention on my talks well, then you may not be able to remember what I am talking in the talks, right? So if you want to remember something, you must listen carefully, listen attentively. You must pay your attention properly. So first step is that sunata. You must listen carefully. And having listened that, you need to put some effort. What is the next step that you need to fulfill, you need to follow? The next step is dharita. The next step is that you need to put some effort, you need to put some dedication, or you need to put some great enthusiasm in order to remember, right? It is not enough just listening to the teachings of the Buddha. And it is not just enough listening to my talk. You need to put some effort in order to remember what I am talking in the talk, right? So that is the second step that you need to go through, you need to undergo. What is the third one? The third one is that charata. That is the most important factor, that is the most important step that you need to undertake or you need to go through. What do you mean by charata? It is not enough just listening, and it is not enough just remember. And the next step is that first you listen, second you will remember, the last one is you need to put them into practice, right, my dear children? But this is a less active among our people nowadays. Our parents of you may go to listen to the teachings of the Buddha many times. Maybe they listen to the talks many times, every day, every month, every hours, or every night, every in the mornings. But sadly, they also may remember the teachings of the Buddha sometimes, but they do not put them into practice, right? Same as you, if you listen to my talks and if you remember them, if you can remember some of them, but if you do not put them into practice, then that is useless, right? So then you must listen carefully, you must try to put some effort to remember. Perhaps you may not be able to remember all the things which I am talking in the talk, but at least you try your best to remember some main points of the talk I am talking. So therefore, the last step is the most important, my dear children. Please try to put them into practice. Try to put these teachings into practice. Then you will be able to taste the real taste of the teachings of the Buddha. That is the purpose of listening to the teachings of the Buddha. It's just like here. This is a common example. This is a usual example that I always take to explain to you, just like this. If you have some sicknesses, if you have some sick, then you go to doctor, right? So when you go to doctor check you, and doctor will prescribe you some medicines, right? And doctor will give you some prescriptions and in order to take some medicines. So, and later you may have medicines and you bring them back, and then you put them in your drawer without taking them accordingly. So will you be able to recover from the sicknesses? Will you be able to get over from the sicknesses? Indeed, no. Right? In the same way, if you listen to the teachings of the Buddha, if you remember them, but if you do not put them into practice, then that is useless. So therefore, my advice is for you to remember, listen, and most importantly, put them into practice. So I hope our children, they follow my advice. So I just want to give you a quick remind or quick overlook what we were talking about last 2 months. We were talking about perfections, right? Paramita. And how many paramitas are there? There are 10 perfections, 10 perfections, or 10 completeness, or 10 virtues. And what are the paramitas? What do you mean by paramita? I just want to give you a quick overlook, or I want to just explain briefly before I start in my today's talk, because I want you to remember something, because we were talking about paramitas in our previous talks. So there are 10 paramitas: perfection in charity, perfection in morality, perfection in renunciation, wisdom, effort, patience, truthfulness, resolution, and loving kindness. So those are the 10 paramitas, 10 perfections. So let's talk about what are the paramitas. Let's talk about what the paramitas are. Paramitas are perfections and wholesome states, wholesome virtues or deeds which need to be completed or which need to be developed in order to attain the final goal of liberation, that is called enlightenment. Forget about enlightenment. If you want to have a good birth in the future, if you practice these 10 perfections, actually you can get a good birth in the future, right? So that is why paramitas are very important. The Lord Buddha said that if anybody practices these perfections for some time, that person will be able to release from this samsara, and that person will be able to get rid of from this cycle of birth and death. And also that person will be able to reborn in a happy destination in the future. Therefore, the Buddha said that practice of perfections, practice of paramitas, practice of paramita is very, very, very crucially important in our life. Therefore, it is very important if you can practice these perfections. And who should practice paramitas? Can you tell me? Who should practice these 10 perfections? Of course, us. Including us, we should practice these perfections. But particularly, Lord Buddha, if somebody wants to become a fully enlightened Buddha, or great Buddha, or Sambuddha, that person has to complete these 10 perfections for many, many years, right? In three levels. Dana parami, parami, upaparami, paramatta parami. Ordinary level, superior level, and supreme level. These three levels of paramitas need to be completed by the person who wishes to be a fully enlightened Buddha in the future. And if somebody wants to become a silent Buddha, also need to fulfill, complete these 10 perfections up to two levels. It's mean 20 paramitas. And also, if somebody wants to become an enlightened being, arahant, that person also has to complete the 10 perfections for many years. Then that person can become an enlightened person. And you know that there are three levels of paramitas: ordinary level, parami, and the superior level, upaparami, and paramatta parami, supreme level. So those are the overlook, those are the background information about the perfections that I explained in my previous talk. So let's talk about today's topic then. Today we are going to talk about the third perfections, right? The Nekkhamma Paramita. That is the today's topic. Listen carefully. This is very important one. This is very useful one to our life. So what is Nekkhamma Paramita? I have four questions to be answered in this Dhamma talk. What is the Nekkhamma Paramita? That is my first question. And why Nekkhamma Paramita is important to our life? And then my second question. And my third one, how Lord Buddha practiced this Nekkhamma Paramita? And I will explain to you some of the Jataka stories as well, and some of the evidence as well, in order to understand very well. And how do you practice Nekkhamma Paramita? That is the most important part of this Dhamma talk. Therefore, my dear children, listen carefully and try to get the things that I am talking, right? So let's answer to the first question. What is the first one? What is Nekkhamma Paramita? I just want to explain according to the explanation of early Buddhist text. Don't worry about this explanation. Anyhow, I will explain to you according to the capacity of your understanding. According to the early text explanation, Nekkhamma means kamaanan nissaranang yadidan nekkamma. That means giving up of attachment, both physical and mental, or giving or letting go, or giving up of attachment to sensual pleasure, right? That is the general meaning of nekkhamma paramita, or renunciation. That is the general meaning of renunciation. It means letting go of the things, mentally and physically. It could be material things and it could be your mental thoughts. So that is the main purpose, that is the general, that is the common explanation according to teachings of the Buddha. Why do we have to give up, or why do we have to let go, and why do we have to renounce from these things physically and mentally? The Lord Buddha said, people who can let go, people who can give up the things physically and mentally, those people can escape from this samsara. Those people can overcome from all the sufferings, right? Therefore, it is very important for someone to be released from this samsara, to practice the practice the perfection of renunciation, right? So that is the general explanation according to the early Buddhist texts. And nekkhamma is a renunciation from all types of things physically and mentally. I will explain to you with examples later on, don't worry about. At this point, try to get just the general meaning of nekkhamma or renunciation. And it is the first of the three intention of the second pact of Noble Eightfold Path. Right, there are eight factors of Noble Eightfold Path. It starts with Samma Ditti, right view. The second one is, second pact is Samma Sankappa. When we talk about the Samma Sankappa, in the category of Samma Sankappa, the first one is Nekkhamma Sankappa, right? The renunciation, intention of renunciation. That is the first one of the second three factors of the second factor of Noble Eightfold Path. And it is also the third factor of 10 perfections, Nekkhamma. So therefore, it is very important topic today we are going to talk about. Children, some people believe, according to early Buddhist texts, some people believe that people can experience, the people can practice these perfections or renunciation only if they become monks and nuns. The person who has gone forth, that means person who has renounced from the lay life to become a monk and nun, then that person can practice renunciation. That is completely wrong. Right? In some extent, up to some levels, that is true. But you don't have to be a monk and nun in order to practice the renunciation perfections. Perfection of renunciation, perfection in renunciation. You don't have to become a monk or nun in order to practice this Nekkhamma Paramita. I will explain to you later on in details. So, in according to times of the Buddha, people who have gone from home to become monks, those people who has renounced from their lay lives to become nuns and monks, and they spend their time under trees or caves or temples or any other secluded places in order to practice their celibacy life. So the people believe that those people who renounce from their lay lives, so they can practice this perfection of renunciation. That is not really true. For example, I am a renounced monk, right? I have given up my lay life, and I have given up my responsibilities in the family. I have abandoned and I have taken away my lay life in order to become a monk, right? So I can be called as a renounced monk, right? It is easy, actually. If you become a monk, it is easy for you to practice, for you to gain the liberation quickly, rather than stay in a lay society. If you stay lay society, if you stay secular society, you have lots of responsibilities and regulation and duties you need to fulfill, right? But when I become a monk, I have less responsibilities. I have less opportunities to serve or like in a lay society. So I have more opportunity, more easy way to become an enlightened person. So therefore, it is very important people, whether you are a monk or nun, whether you are a lay person or not, to practice this Nekkhamma Paramita. But if a lay person lives domestic life permanently, that means if you renounce from your lay life and then if you become a monk and nun, actually that kind of renunciation will help you to gain the enlightenment quickly as compared to lay life, right? For example, if you want to become an enlightened one, so it takes more than 10 years as a monk, then if you are a lay person, if you want to get the enlightened person, if you want to become an enlightened person, it may take 100 years. I just give you an explanation. So as a monk, I may be able to get enlightenment as quickly as I can, rather than you, because you have lots of responsibility in the society. But anyway, forget about the getting enlightenment, but you can practice this Nekkhamma Paramita in order to make your life smooth in this world and also next world. For your level of understanding, Nekkhamma means, my dear children, giving up things or letting go things. It can be material things, right? Physically and mentally. You have to give up your things physically and mentally. Let's talk about in details later on, okay? And also you should give up your bad habits. If you have some bad habits, if you can give up those bad habits, those also kind of forms of renunciation. Later we can explain in details. Why Nekkhamma Paramita is important? Nekkhamma Paramita is very important because if you let go things, if you can let go things away, if you can give up things away, and if you can renounce from some things, from things physically and materially, you may have less worry. You may have peace, and you can actually end your cycle of birth and death, right? That is the Buddha said that finally you can attain the final goal of Nibbana if you practice Nekkhamma Paramita. The Buddha said that those people who have, said it is because of the excessive attachment to physical things, mentally and physically, then those people suffer a lot. And those people will lament a lot. And those people will worry a lot. And they will not be able to release from the cycle of birth and death. Why? Because they have excessive attachment to things physically and mentally. And also he said one day, if you let go a little, you will have a little peace. If you let go a lot, you have a lot peace. If you let go completely, you have complete peace in your mind. Just like monks and nuns and the Lord Buddha. The Lord Buddha has completely given up his all the belongings, physically and mentally. That's why he could experience everlasting happiness, right? So if you want to experience everlasting happiness, what do you need to do? You need to completely give up the things. Once you give up the things completely, you may experience everlasting happiness. It is not quite easy for you to give up everything completely. It needs to have lots of practices. But for your level, if you can let go a little by little, you may have at least little happiness, right? So therefore, my dear children, if you can practice, this is very important. And let's talk about how Lord Buddha practiced this Nekkama Paramita. There are lots of beautiful Jataka stories in the Jataka book. And there are lots of evidence of monks and nuns who practiced this Nekkama Paramita and who got the real benefits of happiness. Right? Let's talk about one example of the Lord Buddha, how he practiced, how he experience how he let go the things and what he got after letting go all his belongings. Children, do you know how Lord Buddha practiced this Nekkama Paramita for many years? The Lord Buddha practiced letting go, giving up, and the renunciation for many thousand years. There are so many beautiful stories to explain to you in the Jataka book. I have selected only few of them, but according to time limitation, I don't have time to tell all the stories, but I just only tell you one or two. Okay? So, one of the Jataka stories of the Buddha's renunciation is explained in Sutta Soma Jataka story. It is 497 of the Jataka story of the Jataka book. And also there is another story, Hattipala Jataka, is the 500 Jataka story of the Jataka book. And also another one is Chulla Sutta Soma Jataka, is the 517th of the Jataka story of the Jataka book. And the last one is Vesantara Jataka, that is 541 of the Jataka story of the Jataka book. Are some of the exemplary stories of the Bodhisattva who practice this Nekkama Paramita. I just want to explain to you one story among them. Sutta Soma Jataka. Once upon a time, there was a king named Renuka in Kururata. Kururata is one of the places in India, and it is a very beautiful place in that time. And in that city, there was a king named Renuka. What is the name of the king? Renuka in India. And this king happened to see a group of ascetics one day. Have you seen ascetics? If you have not familiar with the word ascetics, it's somebody like someone who has given up from the lay life to become a monk, somebody like me. So a group of ascetics from Himalaya. Himalaya is a very great forest in India, and it is a huge forest in India, and lots of ascetics and the Brahmins and the monks spend their times practicing meditation in that jungle in order to gain their spiritual attainments. So among these ascetics, there was a chief ascetic named Maharakshita. He was the chief ascetic among the members of the ascetic of that group. So this Maharakshita, together with other ascetics, they came to the city from the Himalaya. And this king of that Kururata, Renuka, happened to meet this group of ascetics together with the Maharakshita. And having seen their serenity and peaceful behavior and their serenity looking and their calm appearance, the king invited them to spend their rainy retreat or 3 months of Vasana retreat in the palace. So having accepted the king's invitation, the Maharakshita decided to spend 3 months of Vasana retreat or rainy retreat in that palace. So the king looked after this group of ascetics very well. The ascetics were supported by lots of food and necessities, other kind of things, very well. They were well taken care of this king. So one day, this king happened to go to a war, right? You know that in India during the times of the Buddha and even before that, they had lots of wars, right, among states or among the countries, among enemies. They had lots of fights and wars. So one day this king happened to go to a war. Then what happened? Before that war started, this group of ascetic, they spent the times of 3 months in there. Having completed these 3 months, they stepped to go back to Himalaya again. So on their way back to Himalaya, Maharakshita, the great ascetic among those group, he revealed a truth. What is that? He told to the other groups of ascetics that childless king, a king's wife, a queen, has conceived a baby. That means earlier the queens had not conceived babies. The queens was a childless woman. So this Maharakshita ascetic, he could see that queen has conceived a baby. So having known that, this incident, this news spread among that group of ascetics. And among those group of ascetics, there was a cunning and false and fake ascetic. He came to know this news and he thought to himself, oh, this is the best way, this is a good way, this is an excellent way for me to get royal privileges and royal traits. Having thought that, fake ascetic intended himself to think, I must act like I am a sick person. So I must stay back in the palace so I can get privileges and lots of royal supports from the king if I reveal this news to the king. So he thought himself in that way. Having thought in that way, that fake ascetic or false ascetic stay back, and then what he did, he revealed this news to the king. And king was very happy, and he was delighted of hearing this good news. And this false ascetic asked king to look after his wife well, very well, and take care of his queen, a pregnant queen, very well. And having heard about this news, the king was delighted, and he built a temple to this fake ascetic in the palace or in the the royal garden. So having built those beautiful temple to this fake ascetic, he looked after very, very well this fake ascetic. But the king, he did not know whether this person was a fake ascetic or real ascetic. And having predicted that the queen was going to have a baby, having spent 10 months of pregnancy, the queen was able to deliver a baby boy. That baby was named Masutasoma. Somanasa. Somanasa was the name of that prince, right? That's the name of the Jataka story as well. So Somanasa was the prince which was born to this queen. And then when the prince was seven years old, the father, king, had to go for a war, right? So when the king went for the war, he had to spend few months in there. Before he left, he asked his son to look after this ascetic, very well, give him food and whatever things for this ascetic. And then this prince wanted to go and see whether this ascetic is a real one or not real one. So when the prince went there, this ascetic was watering the plants. He was watering the plants. He was cultivating the crops, things, and then he was watering the plants. He was not practicing celibacy life. He was not practicing ascetic life. Instead of that, he was planting the things and he was watering things. Straight away, this Somanasa, he knew that this is not the real ascetic. If he is a real ascetic, he should practice ascetic life. He should practice the things which suits to ascetic life. But he was not a real ascetic. He practices all those cultivations, crops, all those things. So, having thought that, the prince called this ascetic as a farmer. He addressed like, farmer, are you working? Are you working in the field? Are you working in the field? So when this ascetic heard about this word, he got frustrated. He got angry with this prince. And having got angry, ascetic thought to himself, one day I am going to take revenge from this prince. Once his father returns back home, I will reveal this happened and I will get revenge from this prince, naughty, nasty prince. He thought to himself in that way. And having thought in that way, he messed up his house and also he got injured by himself in order to persuade the king to let know that his son did this to me. So after the war is over, the king, Renuka, returned back to his palace. Straight away, he went back to the temple where it was in the royal garden. And when he went there, he saw injured ascetic and the messed house. Then straight away, he asked, what happened to you? Who has done this to you? Who did this to you? Then the fake ascetic say, none of them or not anyone else except your son. Your naughty, nasty son did this to me and he's the one who is responsible for this nasty action. So the king become very furious and got angry. Straight away he ordered his ministers to behead his own son. To kill his own son. And the prince is approached to the king and revealed this incident. Prince approached the king and told, what is the matter? What's wrong? If I call a farmer as farmer, there is nothing wrong as I think. When I went there, I saw he was watering the plant, so I called him a farmer. So what's the matter? So then, king did not believe it. Then the prince asked him to go and investigate if you do not believe my words. So prince advised in that way, preach Dhamma to King Renuka. And the king went there and investigated and then he realized that this is not something he expected to happen. When he see around his temple, he could see all those plantations and all those crops. Having seen those, he thought to himself, this is not the real ascetic. So he apologized his son. And then, having realized these incidents, having realized the useless of privileges or sensual pleasures in palace or royal family, the Soamanasa, he renounced, he left the lay life and he went to Himalaya and he practiced the practiced celibacy life, and he was able to gain the highest spiritual goals like dhyana, and at the end he was born in the Brahma world. So what I want to tell is that in this story, the peg ascetic was a Devadatta, and the prince Soamanasa was Prince Siddhartha or Bodhisattva Siddhartha before becoming the Buddha. So this is one of the stories of the Jataka book to show that how the Bodhisattva practiced renunciation, giving up of the things. Even he had lots of luxurious things, but he gave them away in order to gain the final goal of liberation. And that is the one of the stories that I want to tell you. There are other stories which I quoted at the beginning of the talk. You can read them if you refer to Jataka book story. So then how we should know that further and further? You know that Lord Buddha, when he was in his last birth of a Bodhisattva, he was born as a Vaisantara king, right? During his last birth, being as a Vaisantara king, he was able to give up, let go all of his belongings, including his children, his wife. Why he was able to do those things in that way? Why he was able to give up all those things in that way? Because he had been practicing letting go. He had been practicing this renunciation for many years and years and years, many millions of years. If he had not practiced this renunciation for many years, he would not be able to become a Buddha and fully enlightened Buddha. And also you remember that in his last birth, before becoming the Buddha, he was born as a Prince Siddhartha, right? What happened to him? Prince Siddhartha, he had beautiful three palaces, right? Children, do you remember the story? He had three palaces, one for rainy season, one for summer season, one for winter season. So he had three beautiful palaces for him to use. And he had a very great, huge kingdom, right? His father, King Suddhodana, wanted him to become a future king in that palace, in that region, or in that kingdom. But what happened? What he did? He gave up all these palaces and all these royal pleasures and luxurious things, and he renounced, and he became the fully enlightened Buddha, right? You have to be very grateful to those great dedication and effort of the Lord Buddha. That is how Lord Buddha practiced this Nekkhamma Paramita. There are so many beautiful stories to know and learn, and evidence of the monks and nuns who practiced this Nekkhamma Paramita or perfect renunciation paramita in many lives, right? So that is how people, how Lord Buddha and his monks practiced Nekkhamma Paramita for their liberation. Now let's talk about the most important part of this talk. How we should practice this Nekkhamma Paramita then? What you need to do in order to practice this Nekkhamma Paramita? What steps that you need to follow? What step that you need to take over or take into practice in order to practice this Nekkhamma Paramita? Some people say that being as a lay person, being in a lay society, it is not really applicable or it is not really possible for people to practice renunciation like a lay person. It is not true, dear children. For your level, you can practice many things as a sides of renunciation. You can practice paramita very well by being as a lay person at your home and in your daily life. I will explain to you some of the things that you can practice as a lay person in order to practice this Nekkhama Paramita. Let's talk about the things we can give up and the things that we need to undertake in order to practice Nekkhama Paramita. First one is, you need to practice, you need to observe precepts. There are two types of precepts for you, 5 precepts and also 8 precepts. For my advice for you is, you must practice 8 precepts. By practicing 8 precepts, you can practice some form of renunciation. I will explain to you later. And the second thing is that practice of meditation is also help you to understand the things and helps you to renounce from things, help you to let in go the things, help you to let go the things, help you to overcome or give up the things. And also you can give up your laziness. If you are a lazy person, you can give up your laziness. That is also kind of renunciation, right? You let go, let your laziness go away. That is also kind of renunciation. And also letting go your bad habits, like eating junk food, playing games improperly all the times, and you can use your time productively without playing games always, and also overconsumption of things like clothes, shoes, and other things. I will explain to you one by one later. So let's talk about the precepts. I suggest you to practice 8 precepts. There are 8 factors to be practiced in order to practice renunciation. The Lord Buddha has encouraged that lay people can practice these highest 8 precepts on the full moon for a day. So usually people practice these 8 precepts on full moon for a day, once a month. But if you can practice at least once a week, once a month, that would be fantastic. You will experience the good result of those 8 precepts. For lay people, the spirit of renunciation is contained in the precepts. For your level, for your capable of your lifestyle, according to your level of lifestyle, you can practice these 8 precepts in order to practice some form of renunciation. What is the first precept that you need to practice? Refrain from killing. When you observe precept of abstaining from killing, actually you give up the habits of killing animals. There are some people in this world, they kill animals for fun, right? For pleasure. I have come to know in Australia also, sometimes they go for hunting for pleasure. They go for fishing for pleasure. And they catching all those animals for fun. Do you think that is a good thing? No, that is not a good thing. So when you observe this first precept of abstaining killing, actually you give up your bad habits of killing and harming animals, right? So first thing that you need to practice is first precept of abstaining killing animals. So when you abstain from killing animals, actually you give up your bad habits of killing animals. So second precept, abstaining from telling lies. There are some people in this world, they tell lies for fun. They tell lies for pleasure. They tell lies as games, right? Sometimes they tell white lies. That is not really good. When you practice the precepts of abstaining telling lies, actually you give up bad habit of telling lies. My dear children, try to practice this. Abstaining from telling lies help you to practice the some form of renunciation of telling lies. So you can stay away of telling lies. And when you observe precepts of abstaining from taking intoxicant drinks or intoxicating drinks like drugs and cigarettes or drinks, actually you practice the giving up of bad companies of your friends. Sometimes you may have the friends that you always ask to go and have some parties or have some drinks, have some liquor. So there are some friends like that. At this level you may not have, but in the future you may have. But when you practice these precepts, you know that drinking alcohol is not good. Drinking intoxicated drinks is not good. Taking drugs is not good. So I must give up all those bad friends. The friends who lead, friends who ask to go for bad companies. So you can give up. You can give up those bad habits of taking drugs and taking alcohol by practicing the third precepts, fourth precepts, right? Fifth one. And the I forget one. The third one is when you observe the precepts of abstaining from misuse of your senses, misuse of your senses. Sometimes we use our whole entire body senses in order to do some vulgar things, in order to do some bad things, right? For example, we use our entire senses to play games, to fight with someone, right? And also to score with someone or do whatever other things. We use our senses, we use our eyes, we use our body parts, all those things. So when you observe the kamesu michachara, veramani, abstaining from misuse of your senses, actually it's helped you to overcome or let go some of your bad habits of misuse of your body's senses. And the next one, when you observe the precepts of abstaining from eating in the afternoon, I'm talking about on the observant day, if you practice these eight precepts, so there are eight precepts that you need to observe, right? When you observe the precepts of abstaining from taking food in the afternoon after 12 o'clock on the full moon day, actually you can limit your food, the craving for your food. And some people, they have very greedy mind, greediness or stinginess for some food, right? So sometimes if they can practice these precepts and if they can stay away from taking three meals per day on that day, actually they are practicing the celibacy life, practicing the letting go, practicing the letting go of the craving of the food, craving for the food, right? So in that way, actually, my dear children, you are practicing the great practices of the great disciples of the Buddha. And also, the last, the seven precepts, when you observe the precepts of abstaining from distractions in the forms of games, music, cosmetics, you can minimize and control the attachment to all those entertainments and beautifying your bodies on that day, right? Nacha Gita Vadita. So in that way, when you observe these precepts, actually it helps you to have less attachment to these things. You have a lesser attachment to these sensual pleasures or material things because you practice observe these precepts. And also when you observe the last precepts of eight precepts, abstaining from using luxurious things on the observance day, you practice the simple style of your life. You don't need to have a comfortable bed to sleep on that day. These are kind of awkward or kind of strange practices for you, I know. But if you can practice these precepts, actually it will help you to practice some form of renunciation, letting go or craving or attachment to things. When you have less attachment to things, actually you have good peace and less worry in your daily life. By giving up this, even for just temporary, helps us to reduce and recognize the strong attachment or pleasure to those things. Therefore, the Buddha's advice is, if you want to become an enlightened person, or if you want to release from the cycle of births and deaths, And if you want to have a good birth or happy destination in the future, please try to practice these 8 precepts. These 8 precepts will bring you good results, and you may able to practice some forms of renunciation as well. And the second thing that you need to do is practice of meditation. So when you practice, there are 2 types of meditation in Buddhism. We call Samatha meditation, calmness meditation, and also Vipassana meditation, insight meditation. When you practice Samatha meditation, calmness meditation, it helps you to develop awareness or mindfulness in your mind. When you practice insight meditation, Vipassana meditation, it helps you to develop wisdom. So when you have wisdom and mindfulness, actually then you can use that wisdom and mindfulness not to attach things badly or severely. You can use those wisdom, mindfulness in order to practice renunciation or nekkhamma paramita very well. And also giving up laziness. Some people are very lazy. They don't want to practice the things. They don't want to practice the Dhamma. They don't want to study hard. They don't want to help their parents. Why? Because they are lazy. So laziness is not a good quality in your life. It is a bad quality. You need to give it up. You need to let your laziness go away. You need to overcome from your laziness. You need to eradicate your laziness permanently. Right? So when you do not have laziness, you can perform the things productively. Right? You can study well. You can do other things very well productively if you do not have laziness. So if you practice the letting go, the laziness is also kind of practicing renunciation, nekkhamma paramita. And also the fourth one, the last one, you can practice or you can let go your bad habits. Some people, some children, they have some bad habits. What are those bad habits? They have bad habits of eating junk food, right? They always demand, I want to buy McDonald's, I want to buy KFC, please mother, father, go and buy me KFC, go and buy me a McDonald's. I don't want to eat this curry, that curry, this rice. I'm fed up of eating this food. So in that way, they requested, they demand their parents to buy those junk food, right? So that is also kind of bad habit. You're demanding your parents to buy those things, junk food, unhealthy food, right? Those are bad. So you can give up. You can give up those bad qualities. You can let go those bad qualities. You can stay away from those bad qualities. So that is also kind of renunciation. The next one, playing games. Nowadays, there are so many young children, even small children, they always play games unnecessarily. They spend hours and hours playing games. That is not good. You can give up playing games, not permanently, but sometimes you can reduce playing games. If you play games for 5 hours, you can minimize or reduce up to 1 hour per day, right? So if you use that time, extra time, to do something else, you can use your time productively, do something else for your studies, right? So in that way, you can actually practice giving up or renunciation, giving up your some bad habits, right? So the other thing is that I want to tell is that overconsumption of things like clothes, I just want to know. And I know that, I came to know that in some time, some families, some children, they have 50 types of clothes, right? Sometimes more than 50 types of clothes, right? Whenever the new arrivals of clothes, they always go and buy. Sometimes the clothes, they don't really need new clothes. They still can use their old clothes. But they still want to buy things. Why? Because they follow the passion. They want to show up. It is okay, nothing wrong with that. But that is not a good practice for your life. So you don't need to buy clothes unnecessarily if you really don't need them, right? If you have 50 types of clothes, you can stop buying new clothes again. You can reuse them again and again. If you don't want to reuse them again, don't put them into bin, or waste them. Waste them by destroying those clothes. Instead of that, you can donate those clothes to your families, or you can give those clothes away to all those community centers, right? And you can give, like, in Australia, I think there's a Red Cross, I don't really remember that one. So, or you can bring those old clothes to op shops, right? Second-hand shops. You can give them to those shops and op shops. So there are so many people in this world, they can reuse those products, those clothes. So that is also kind of practicing renunciation, my dear children. You give away your things to someone who needs them. And also, sometimes you may have lots of shoes, pair of shoes, maybe 50 or 30. Sometimes you may, I have seen those habits. When I go to dana of some people's house, lunch or breakfast dana at some people's house, I can see there are so many pairs of shoes in front of the house, right? Sometimes we only need one or two pairs of shoes, but they unnecessarily buy the things. That is also kind of wasting the things. You don't need to buy the shoes if you do not really need them. You can reuse them. If you don't want to reuse them, what you need to do is that you can bring them and you can donate them to community centers or op shops, so they may reuse them. Isn't that a good practice, my dear children? That is a good practice. When you practice these simple things, these common things, actually you are practicing the form of renunciation. That is the renunciation according to a level. You don't have to be a monk or nun in order to practice renunciation, but if you can practice those things, those simple things, actually you practice the form of renunciation. So when you practice all those things, actually it gives you happiness, right? It gives you happiness in this life, and also it gives you good results in the future, right? So when you give away the things to the needy people, you can have a good birth in the future, my dear children. So always try to practice in that way. Whatever things that you have, extra things, please give them away. And also I want to tell you something. I will take another 5 or 10 minutes, my dear children, because it's a very big topic, so apologize for me. So how you should give? You should give things physically and mentally, not just by physically. In the modern time, people usually give the things physically, not mentally, right? For example, they come to temple, and they say, I want to offer this to monks, and I want to offer this to temple, right? And then they offer. But then when they go to the society, or when they meet their friends, and they want to tell, they usually tell, oh, this thing offered by me, I offer this thing. This tree was planted by me. This building was built by me. And that requisite offered by me to the monks. So in that way, they try to put their names, or try to say, these things was offered by me, that things was given by me. So is that a real way of giving? Is that the real way of practicing renunciation? Indeed, no. That means you only give the things physically only, not mentally. But mentally you should give, right? So that types of give is the good way of give, not just physical. Even though you give the things physically, but mentally you still attach to those things. That's why, oh, this tree was planted by me, that things I gave to monk, this thing was offered by me to monk. That is not the way of giving. That means you still have a strong attachment to those things, right? Then you should give them give the things away physically and mentally. Most importantly, mentally. Okay? And sometimes I have seen in Sri Lanka and sometimes here also. When they want, the devotees, when they want to offer something, they want to put, they want to write their names on it. Maybe not their names, sometimes they put departed relatives' name on the objects. I offer these things on behalf of my late father. I offer this thing on behalf of my late brother and sister. So in that way, they put their labels on the items, right? So the funny thing is that when they come to temple, and they usually ask, "Oh, Venerable Sir, do you still use the thing? Do you still use that pot, the kettle, the rice cooker I offer to temple? Do you still use that? If you do not, please use it. It's a very expensive one, very useful one, very valuable one." So in that way, they tell those things. When they tell those things, do you think they have really given up the things? No. They have given the things up only physically, but mentally they still attach to those things. That is not the way of the real giving. The Buddha explained to you, my dear children, you must practice renunciation. You must let go things both physically and mentally. And then you can experience the real happiness of giving away things. If not, you can't practice the things very well. So therefore, what I want to tell is that whenever you have the things, extra things, whenever the things that you think that you really don't need, don't waste them. Don't put them in the bin. I have seen in Australia many times when I go outside Podana, I have seen lots of good things they put outside the road. Maybe they say they consider they are hard rubbish, right? But they still can use. Why they don't bring them into community centers? Why they don't bring those things to OPSOPs? They think that is wasting money to drive those things to that place. It's wasting my time to drive those things, to bring those things to that community centers. Don't think in that way. People become very lazy and people become very selfish in this modern world. They do not practice the good things. Maybe sometimes they do not know the importance of practicing of giving away the things. So, my dear children, if your parents do such things, please stop them. Please tell them, don't put them outside of the house or beside the main road. Instead of that, please bring them to the community centers or OPSOPs. Please bring them in that way. There are so many people in this world who are lacking of a lot of things, food, clothes, and other things. So when you practice these things, actually you are practicing the practice of renunciation. You don't have to become a monk. You don't have to become a nun. You don't have to go from your lay life to become a monk and nuns in order to practice the Nekkhama Paramita. You can practice all these simple, common things by staying at home, right? So therefore, this is what I want to tell, this is what I want to explain, and this is what I want to clarify according to the teachings of the Buddha with regard to the explanation of renunciation, Nekkhama Paramita. So this is the end of the talk, and let's sum up what we have talked today. Let's briefly go through the things that we talk about today. It's help you to remember, okay? So at the beginning of the talk, we talk about the first questions, what is the Nekkhama Paramita? Second, we answered why Nekkhama Paramita is important. And the third, we explain how Lord Buddha practiced this Paramita, Nekkhama Paramita. And I explained one of the Jataka stories of the Lord Buddha and also his life stories. And also the last part of the talk, we talk about how we should practice this Nekkhama Paramita as lay people. So these are the things that I covered throughout this talk, I hope that you understand my talk in up to some certain level. If you do not understand the talk, please try to listen it again and again. And if you do not, still if you do not understand, please come to temple and contact me. I can explain to you very well. So let's transfer merits to divine beings and celestial beings. You have taken part of this great Dhamma service. These meritorious actions have been taken part of these great meritorious actions. This incident or these actions, you have accumulated lots of merits. So those merits be with all the all those celestial beings and divine beings. May all divine beings and celestial beings be able to rejoice of these good merits. Having rejoiced of these good merits, may all divine beings be able to extend and enhance their celibacy life. Having enhanced their celibacy life, may they extend their protections, guidance, and care towards the people who sponsored for this Dhamma talk to be completed well, as I expected. And may all the children who are listening to this talk from their houses be well and happy. May all the children be protected by the blessings of the gods and divine beings. May all the children be protected and guided towards the happiness. And may all the divine beings all also be able to attain the final goal of Nibbana. Having that, we recite these stanzas together. ආකාශත්තාච බුම්මත්තා දේවා නාග මහිද්దికා පුඤ්ඤන්තං අනුමෝදිත්වා චිරන් රක්ඛන්තු ශාසනං ආකාශත්තාච බුම්මත්තා දේවා නාග මහිද්దికා පුඤ්ඤන්තං අනුමෝදිත්වා චිරන් රක්ඛන්තු දේශනං ආකාශත්තාච බුම්මත්තා දේවා නාග මහිද්దికා පුඤ්ඤන්තං අනුමෝදිත්වා චිරන් රක්ඛන්තු ත්වං සදා. Finally, I wish you all the best, good luck and good health. May all your wishes and expectation come true. May you be well and happy. May you be able to study hard. May you be able to achieve your goals as you expected. May all your wishes and expectations come true. May no any difficulties come to you. May no any harms come to you. May you be able to lead your life healthily, happily, peacefully, without any worries and problems. Finally, may all of you be able to attain the final goal of Nibbana. Wishing that we recite these stanzas together. Imina punya kammena mame bala samagamo satan samagamo hotu yava nibbana pattiya. Idamme punyam asavakkaya vahan hotu sabba dukkha pamunchatu. Abhivadana silissa nicchang vaddha pachayino chattaro dhamma vaddhanti ayuvanno sukambalam. ආයුරෝග්‍ය සම්පatti සග්ග සම්පatti මේවච අතෝ නිබ්බාන සම්පatti මිනාතේ සමිජ්ජතු. Okay, wish you all the best.